Tony Ackerman here. That's the beginning of my piece called 11 O'Clock Special. Today, we're going to dig down deep into some of the roots of the piece. And then I'll play the whole thing at the end. It's basically just an improvisation, which I shaped together for my solo CD in 2015. It took maybe an hour. But when I think back at all of the musicians, the styles, the experiences that the piece reflects, I realized that it actually took 61 years to write. So why exactly 61 years? Because at age 4, a few years before my love affair with the guitar started, I started to take piano lessons with a friend of my mother's. The piano totally shaped my young brain and heart. And not just the musical parts. I just loved the physicality of my fingers on the black and white notes, climbing the mountains and descending the valleys. On the piano, the left hand often will provide a rich accompaniment to the melody in the right by this technique of broken chords called arpeggio. Arpeggio, from the Italian word for harp. How nice and angelic. Harpage. I remember the sense of power, of magic, when I was first able to put together the left hand and the right hand to make a complete sound on a nice, pretty piece. Let's see if I can remember something from then. Let's see. So it was natural that when I took up the guitar, I'd be drawn to venture beyond the simple strumming of chords under a song to a fuller, more complex accompaniment, finally allowing me to totally free the guitar from attachment to any song or text. Well, life brought me to the right place for that. When I was 11, we moved to Cambridge, Massachusetts, where my father took up his position teaching at Harvard. That first fall, he took me to a concert in Boston's Jordan Hall, headlined by Pete Seeger, whom I spoke about in the last episode as my musical nanny. Along with Pete was his brother Mike, leading a group with the wonderful name of the New Lost City Ramblers. I was simply entranced by their joy in playing, the bounce of the fiddle tunes, the high harmonic drawls. Their mission was to recreate the authentic Southern folk music styles, old-time hillbilly music, fiddle tunes, ballads that had made their way over from England and Scotland, and even the more bluesy sounds of the Black South. If I was to pinpoint one event which set me on the path to making music my life, it was this concert, fall 1961. The next day after the concert, I hurried down to Harvard Square to buy their first album. The first song on the first side, called Forked Deer. A fiddle tune. Although the Ramblers, of course, sang old love songs and ballads and had quite haunting voices, it was the instrumental parts that caught my 11-year-old heart. It was not long before I got my dad to buy me an old banjo and mandolin in a pawn shop. And I spent hours on the living room floor, listening and copying every note, note for note. Here's the first Ramblers song I learned on the banjo, I Truly Understand. At 11 years old, I doubt that I truly understood that forlornness of lost love. but I did truly understand that plunky, modal, driving sound of the banjo. Listen how the banjo just takes off after the verse, becoming a voice all on its own. It was in the college towns that the so-called urban folk revival really took off. In Harvard Square, there was a little hole-in-the-wall shop with used instruments called New Scene Folklore. Every day after school, I'd bicycle down there and take every instrument off the wall and play it, and spend all afternoon. I'm amazed the owner tolerated me. But my real mecca was the legendary Club 47. A dingy hole in the wall a few blocks away from Harvard Square, where graduate students would gather to read newspapers, drink coffee, and, in the evenings, listen to folk singers who sang from a crude stage just slightly elevated with just one mic. My parents would drive me down there some weekends so I could hear Joan Baez, Ritchie Havens, and Tom Rush, and also groups like the Charles River Valley Boys that were patterned after the New Lost City Ramblers. On Sunday nights, the club had hootenannies, which is a hokier word for open mics. Shortly after I learned I truly understand, I climbed shakily up onto that little stage and sang in the little soprano thin voice, "I truly understand." Of course, the audience thought it was really cute that an 11-year-old would be frailing the banjo and singing an Appalachian song of lost love. And soon I became something like the club mascot. They even started letting me in for free. One of my earliest favorites was a wonderful singer named Jackie Washington. I loved his flowing guitar playing and clear voice. Soon we got him over to the house to teach me some guitar lessons, and he was the first person to show me what is sometimes called three-finger picking or Travis picking. I call it alternate thumb picking because the thumb is so active. Thumb plays the bass like a stride piano. Jackie played a lot of songs by an older West Coast singer named Elizabeth Cotton. The legend is that as a child, she would in secret make off with her brother's guitar, put it on her lap, and work out these nice tunes with complex bass parts. What many guitarists didn't know then, since we only saw her on records, was that she was left-handed and turned the guitar upside down so that her thumb was playing the melody and the fingers were playing the bass. So we were trying to copy her style upside down, and that helped us to really get our thumbs in shape. Here's how Jackie Washington taught me to play Libba Cotton's classic song, Freight Train. First, the song goes like this. It goes, freight train, going so fast. Freight train, going so fast. So first, you work on the bass notes with your thumb. Alternating as you can see. Then, you learn the melody, but you have to keep your fingers on the chord, so you have to use your extra fingers to play the melody. Now, you gotta put them together. Not so easy. Then, you syncopate the melody a little bit and add some extra fingers there. Thank you, Jackie Washington, for insisting that I develop an independent thumb. One evening, Jackie stayed over for dinner, and he was telling us, you know, there are a lot of good folk singers up here in the Boston area, but there's one guy who sometimes comes in from New York and sits in with us in the coffee houses. He sounds just different. It's almost like he's got more to say than the rest of us. His name is Bob Dylan. One afternoon during the off hours, I wandered into Club 47 just to hang around carrying my mandolin case. And there, sitting at the piano, playing Boogie Woogie, is this scrappy guy with hair sticking up every which way. And he looked kind of like Bob Dylan that I recognized from the magazines. In fact, he was Bob Dylan. When he saw me, he said, "Hey kid, what you got in that case? Come on over and jam with me." To my eternal regret, I said, "No thanks." I was just shy because I'd heard from Jackie that this guy was going to be a star. By now, around 1963, blues enthusiasts, inspired by the old 78 records from the 20s and 30s, had started traveling down to the South to unearth the singers from those records who were still alive. They bought them new guitars and new sets of teeth, and brought them up to the college towns to tour. So in Club 47, I got to hear all these old blues greats, Son House, Skip James, Mance Lipcomb, Lightnin' Hopkins, but my favorite guitar player of all of them was this guy, Mississippi John Hurt. I was drawn to the complexity of his playing, the bass notes that never faltered, the syncopated melody lines, the ringing of the open strings placed just right. Let's listen to Stagolee, a song about a gambling man who kills his opponent just because he takes his hat instead of his money. You hear that opening riff? That's what inspired the beginning of 11 o'clock special.
Oh, listen, officer, how can it be? You can arrest everybody, but cruel Stagolee, that bad man. Oh, cruel Stagolee. Stagolee, Stagolee, please don't take my life. Says I got two little babe and a darling loving wife. He's a bad man, oh cruel Stagolee.
Another root of the song is right here. This guitar, the Martin D28. I call it the Cadillac of American guitars. The D in the name stands for Dreadnought, a design that Martin Company pioneered in the 30s. New shape, squarer, bigger, stronger construction of the neck, so he could get a louder and fuller sound. They took the name Dreadnought, Fear Not, from a British battleship that had big guns, steam turbines, and fortified armored side. Get the point? The D28 is most known as a bluegrass and country instrument because listen to these bass notes, how they can make a great underpinning for all the fancy stuff that the other instruments do. But the D28 also has a clear, beautiful upper register. So, what a great instrument for alternate thumb picking. Such a balance of treble and bass. So this particular guitar is an essential part of 11 o'clock special. I wouldn't even dream of playing it on any of my others. So, though I'd never play 11 o'clock special on my nylon string guitar, and although my study of classical guitar was literally and musically worlds away, its imprint is all over the song. In classical guitar, you play with thumb and these three fingers, whereas in a lot of the other alternate styles, you play with just thumb and two or thumb and one. Also in classical guitar, you spend a lot of time perfecting, looking for a sustained and even tone, not only with your left hand, but with your right hand as well. And see these nails? Well, I learned how to lengthen them and how to strengthen them using baking powder, super glue, and gluing ping pongs to the inside of the nail, and manicure acrylic, and then I sand them down, each one with several degrees of sandpaper. Make a totally smooth surface, which produces a beautiful, clean attack. Now, to the title of the song. The Midnight Special is a well-known prison song made famous by the great Leadbelly, who actually was in prison when he was discovered by a musicologist who persuaded the governor of Louisiana to let him out so he could bring his music to the world. Oh, let the Midnight Special shine the light on me. Let the Midnight Special shine that ever-loving light on me. I call my song the 11 o'clock special, since I only work up to playing the Midnight Special just for a bit at the end. Also, because my father, for whom I wrote the song, had his birthday in November, the 11th month. And if you hear the song ending more in swing than in country and blues, you're right, because my father's first musical love was Benny Goodman and the 30s swing bands, so I put some jazzy chords in at the end. Whew. A short song and so many roots. The piano, old-time string band music, Mississippi John Hurt, Elizabeth Cotton and their finger picking, a gambling song, a prison song, southern music, black and white, this awesome guitar, classical guitar technique, swing bands, Benny Goodman, my father. Whew. Hope you enjoy it. See you next weekend. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button on your way out. Be well, my friends.